afternoon, and welcome back to Bio 190. Happy Tuesday if you are watching this live. Otherwise, if you're watching this archive or on YouTube, I hope you're having a good day. Today is day number 3 of our Bio 190 semester. Most of you should be well on your way to completing the assignments that were due within the first few weeks. While I understand that many of you had some problems logging into Blackboard, you should have your username and password. If you are just watching these classes, that is just a small portion of the class. You do need to be logging into Blackboard. Thus far, you should have taken 2 quizzes and participated in 2 discussions. Now, if that's news to you, that's okay. You still have about a week, if not a little bit more than a week, to do those. But your first step is to log on to Blackboard. And if time permits later on in this class, we will go online together on the Blackboard, and I'll show you exactly how to do that. Everyone should have received an email from me today, so go ahead and check your email through Kelsey Dominguez Hills, and that will also outline what should have happened already in your Bio 190 semester to keep you well on your way to completing the course successfully in December. Today we are going to be talking about sharks, and we do have someone here from the aquarium, as usual, to talk to us about sharks, and her name is Sabrina. Welcome, Sabrina.
Welcome. Thank you.
You're welcome. So, we are going to be talking about sharks today with Sabrina, and she is, in fact, kind of our resident shark expert, if you will, in the department, because she teaches our shark training to all of our incoming volunteers. Almost monthly, we have new volunteers come to the department, and they are a very, very important part of our department at the aquarium, and they must know about sharks. And so Sabrina teaches them all the neat things about sharks, and there are a lot of neat things, and so she's going to hopefully share all those really fun facts with us today. We are now going to go live to the Aquarium of the Pacific, which is also always one of my favorite things to do, rather. Even though I've just come from there, it's just so neat to be able to bring you guys virtually back to a very beautiful place. And today we're going to Tropical Landing, and in fact, our biggest exhibit at the Aquarium, Tropical Pacific, rather. And we are joined by Catherine. You there? Hi, guys. So Catherine and Emily, who's also, maybe you're going to see her on Blackboard a little bit, guys. She is helping with this class. We also have Michelle there. So a lot of people bringing us these beautiful images from the aquarium. So again, Catherine, I know we're looking here at tropical, but more specifically, what do you have for me there? What is that?
Microscope. microscopic teeth. They are razor sharp teeth, but they're very, very small. So she's not able to rip into big creatures like a great white who has huge teeth that can eat seals and sea lions. Instead, she, with those tiny teeth, goes after tiny prey, so a small little fish or shrimp, things that she can grab and actually chew, and will not chew with small teeth rather than large teeth.
Now, Catherine, I think a lot of our visitors that are standing, I can even hear them around you, and in fact, some people, here we have one of our stingrays, we want to definitely mention that one before it gets too far out of our vision, but a lot of people are wondering, we see a lot of the smaller fish there in the background as well. Don't those big sharks, like this one and like that zebra shark, go after some of those fish? In addition to that, we have scuba divers that get here on a daily basis, every few hours. Are they nervous about the sharks?
Definitely not. And this is a replication of a natural habitat out in the ocean. Sharks and stingrays would naturally be swimming around other species of sharks. In some cases, they're prey species. But sharks only hunt when they're hungry, and sharks have a very slow metabolism. So once a shark has a good filling meal, it can go for days, and some species weeks without eating again. So the idea that sharks are always on a constant hunt, looking for males, always hunting and eating things in the ocean, is actually false. Here in the aquarium, they can safely swim around all of these other fishes and never feel hungry because we feed the sharks at a specific time every single day, which is more than they would normally get out in the wild. So we keep our sharks' bellies nice and full on a daily basis so they never go hungry and start feeding on the other animals or even nibbling on our divers. So divers and other fish in our exhibits are perfectly safe for the sharks. We keep them nice and full.
All right, that's a barracuda that just swam by there, guys. A lot of really beautiful fish and sharks represented here. Well, we're going to go ahead and talk a lot more about sharks, but we want to thank you for showing us some sharks live straight from the aquarium on this lovely afternoon. Thanks, Catherine.
My pleasure.
All right, guys, we're back in the studio, and we'll get rid of that microphone. We don't need that one anymore. And yes, I did cut my hair, for those of you that were wondering. I just wanted to mention it. It's all gone. I'm donating it, and it feels lovely. Okay, so what are sharks? And my hair is not sharks. So last week, Sabrina, we did have a bony fish day. And when we were with Milena, we, I think, referenced quite a few times the difference between a shark and a bony fish. While they are both fish, there are a few fundamental differences, right? So what is the big difference in your opinion?
The biggest difference is that sharks are cartilaginous fish, so they don't have any bones in their body. They are vertebrates, so they have a spine, just like bony fish do, but it's completely composed of cartilage, like the softer structures in your nose and in your ears. It's more flexible. They're better swimmers than bony fish typically, and they have the same components as bony fish do. They have scales, they have the similar fins, and they have gills. The other big difference is that they have 5 gills instead of 1 gill. So bony fish have an operculum, that 1 gill opening, whereas sharks and stingrays or cartilaginous fish have 5 on average, typically, gill slits.
So we're going to get to that a little bit later when we talk about their senses. And I said, in your opinion, what's the big difference? But certainly it is well known, obviously, that the body of sharks is made entirely of cartilage. One thing that really throws people off is the jaw, that we think, okay, well, surely the jaw and the teeth are bone. But that's not true either, right?
No. Yeah, actually, the only thing that resembles bone in their body is their teeth. That actually has a similar chemical components. That is the only thing that actually fossilizes in their bodies, so and that's how we know about the history of sharks, specifically from fossils of their teeth that have been left behind in the sand and the rocks.
And you make a really good point there. For that reason, it actually makes it a little bit more difficult to study sharks with not a lot of their body
exactly
remaining when they decompose. So cartilaginous body, a lot of times what we do with kids is have them actually reach up to their ear and fold it in half, move it all around. Not that a shark is that bendy or you can fold a shark in half, but just gives you the sense, or gives children rather, the sense of what cartilage is and that their entire body is made of that cartilaginous material. But they are by no means the only one. In fact, they have a few other organisms that are in their big group of cartilaginous fish. Tell us about that.
There are chimeras. They're another type of cartilaginous fish, and they look very similar. they have some very unique colorations, and their fins are very elongated, similar to that tail of the zebra shark that we saw. Can kind of compare how their fins look to the fins of a leafy sea dragon.
Okay. And then, of course, there are sea rays and also skinks. So, and then there's guitar fish, there are a few creatures. So sharks, stingrays, and skates, and then there's a bullmouth guitar fish at the aquarium. She's actually in that same exhibit that we saw, but she didn't swim by. Unfortunately, she hangs out kind of on the other side. And then we have a local shovelnose guitar fish. But you know, the idea is that sharks, rays, and skates are all kind of cousins, if you will, because they are all cartilaginous that they do share. So we're going to stay with sharks a little bit, but we will touch on stingrays and skates throughout our class today. When you take a look at a shark, and we're going to see a picture of a bull shark here in a minute, you definitely see one common characteristic, and it's not all sharks, because there are hundreds of species of sharks in the world, more specifically about 400, right? So many,
about 410 different species of sharks.
Okay, so as usual in science guys, it's hard to make that hard and fast rule, so we'll say most have that special body form. We talked a little bit about it last week, but it's that football shape. See a lot with sharks. How does that help them?
That gives them a more streamlined shape to their body. It helps them move through the water much like our torpedo does or an airplane does through the air. So that fusiform shape or football shaped body helps them with hydrodynamics. It's the same as aerodynamics, basically just in the water there. So they swim with a lot more ease having that shape. And we'll talk about some other features that do help them to swim with those size and shape.
And we'll talk about the unfortunate news that comes when you take off those gills when we get into our conservation section a little bit later in our class. One characteristic that all stingrays have is, as we go back a little bit to talk about those stingrays, and some sharks have, which is pretty surprising news to some people, is something called spiracles. So Sabrina, Dad just mentioned the gills, obviously for gills being fish, and you can see gills on the side of the shark. There's those five gill slits, as they're called. But that's not really the only way that some sharks rather breathe, right? They have a secondary function, and all stingrays have the secondary function. Tell us about why stingrays and sharks need it.
Definitely. Well, primitive sharks all have spiracles. And so more open ocean sharks today, the larger species, have lost them, and they have a flap of skin that covers the spiracle. The spiracles are typically found behind the eye. It's a small to large opening, depending on the animal that you're looking at, and it is an alternate way for them to breathe. So typically, sharks and rays and skates now have those that are bottom-dwelling animals, because when their gills are covered by the sand as they're camouflaging, they can't pull the water through their gills. So they use that spiracle on top of their head, kind of like a little snorkel, to pull in water. That water then passes through the gills internally, and then they can breathe.
And it's really neat. We'll see right here on the picture just behind me there. You can see the eyes. And in fact, a lot of visitors at the aquarium think that the holes that they're seeing are the eyes, right? And in this picture, you can see very distinctly the difference. The eyes are actually set in front of, I'll use my nifty tool here. The eyes are set in front of the spiracles right there. And again, the idea is that their gills are on the bottom. If you've ever seen the bottom of a stingray, you can just very clearly see them. And they're sitting on them. And in fact, a lot of times, not only are they just resting on the sand, but they're under the sand. So they literally may be having a hard time breathing. And so those spiracles are then drawing in that water and helping them. Again, I think it was once I started working at the aquarium, it wasn't that I realized that some sharks have them as well, but I thought it was always a characteristic of stingrays alone. Before we leave the stingray here, we are going to talk about fins. It's kind of hard to relate shark fins to stingrays. I think the only one really are those pectoral fins. So while the stingray looks like a big swimming circle, the things you're seeing flat up and down, those are considered the pectoral fins. So with that being said, let's go ahead and take a look at the bull shark. And we did this last week, but we'll briefly go through the fins of this bull shark you see in the background. So if you would, Sabrina, walk us through the fins as I highlight them here and tell us their purpose for sharks.
Definitely.
So one of the things we can look at are those major fins. So the fin on the top of its back is called the dorsal fin, and that's typically used for balance. If a shark does not have that fin, it actually spins through the water, and you can see that with an easy demo with a football. If you take a football and you add a fin to it, it's going to stop it from spinning through the air. And so especially when a shark uses its dorsal fins, it spins through the water, and it can't access its environment effectively when it's spinning through the water like that.
Okay.
And then the ones that are on the side, the lowest lateral fins are called the pectoral fins. And those also help with balance, and the fact that they help them with steering. And also allow them to kind of stay a little straight as well with that dorsal fin. So those both act together for straight movement. It gives them lift like the wings of an airplane does as well. And the back fin, that's another major fin, that's the tail fin. It's also known as a caudal fin. And that essentially propels the shark forward. Now this isn't the case in most sharks, not all, because there are sharks that swim with oscillating their pectoral fins if they are depressed in shape, flat shape, and have stingrays and skates. So this is typical for most. Now they also have anal fins that offset their dorsal fins, and they also have pelvic fins that offset the dorsal fins. And those are just for extra balance.
So the biggest difference between the whitefish and the sharks is that these don't really undulate. Like you said, they're pretty rigid. And so some of the fish we saw, even in the live male pier, swimming with their pectoral fins, while that doesn't happen all that often, it can a little bit with the stingrays, but with the sharks specifically, they are fairly rigid pieces of cartilage. And again, we'll talk later about what's called shark finning, the cutting off of the fin, and the detriment that is happening to shark populations. But we just highlighted why a shark cannot survive without its fin. Sharks have the same five senses as we talked about with bony fish that you and I have. In addition to that, they have a sixth sense. It might surprise you at which distance they can do these senses. So let's start with the one that's farthest away. And you might be thinking right now that, you know, we've all heard that myth, right, of sharks can smell one drop of blood in a million drops of water. So surely smelling is their best sense, correct?
Well, it depends on how you interpret it, actually. So, if you're looking at distance, which is what is typical for how strong their sense is, then it's actually hearing. They can hear low-frequency sounds up to a mile away. They have small openings on the side of their head that bring in sound, and sound does travel faster through the water than it does through the air.
And I think that's fascinating, because when you look at a shark, you don't see these big external air flaps. As we mentioned, again, with bony fish, a lot of comparisons to last week's lecture, for sure. There are holes there. They are very hard to see, and it's just fascinating that can be one of their best senses. So what are they hearing? Well, they are listening, if you're a bigger shark, possibly for an injured seal or sea lion, crashing water, those kinds of things. And it's hard to imagine what are they hearing underwater. You know, we don't know that world as well. So, but certainly I would imagine that it is very much part of their predatory instinct and how they find a lot of it, right? Smelling. They so can swell up. We'll see that later as well, shark. Smelling is what I meant, however, is a very strong sense, though. And how far away do they have to do it?
Distance-wise, they can smell up to 1,000 feet away. And that's why it's termed as their second best sense. If you look at how much brain activity is devoted to it, 70% of the brain is devoted towards smell. So with looking at brain activity as what you're using to interpret as a sense, then that can be considered the top sense. But distance-wise, it is second, which we're not typically familiar with.
Right. And there again, it's hard to see their nose. It's called their nares or their nostrils. If you get an up-close view, you can see it a little bit better. And there's even more going on the nose of a shark. And we'll get to that as we continue down the line of their senses as we get a little bit closer to the shark. So now imagine that we're 300 feet away from the shark. What sense kicks in at this point?
This is going to be their lateral line.
This is basically a line that we can't see. It's not visible to our eyes, and it's typically right down the center of the body of a shark. You can usually see it where you see a color change on their body. That's called countershading. And so this is a line of pores, microscopic pores. They're fluid-filled, and they each have a small sensory ear also that helps them to detect movement. So it's kind of an extension on their ability for touch, feeling on their skin.
And we do have a picture here, and with sharks, you can't see it. They Sabrina mentioned on bonyfish, you can see them a little bit better, and we have a picture. So this is those pores, such as you're describing. Again, you can't see that here, but each one has this little hair on its body. And it's not even described as a hair, really, right? Is it a sensory structure?
It's a sensory structure. It still looks similar to a hair.
It's
beautiful.
It's so funny. I agree.
They don't typically really have hair.
It's funny to think of them as having a line of hair. Okay, or hair-like structures, you should say. Alright, so 300 feet away, guys, they can use this to sense changes, water pressure changes in the water. With bonyfish all schooling together, we'll be changed, so let's all change. This might be, again, a predatory instinct. And so, a thrashing sailor sea lion, obviously the water pressure in that area is going to be changing. Maybe the shark uses that, again, as a way to go find why the pressure difference is, why the water is changing in one specific area. Imagine that we're moving even closer to a shark. We're now 70 feet away. So if a mile away, the animal was able to hear us, up to 1,000 feet away, smell us, 300 feet away, sensing us using that lateral line, 70 feet away, it can finally see. Immediately 70 feet away. Now that might sound like a lot, but 70 feet really is not all that far in the water.
That's pretty much their maximum distance for seeing. On average, it's 30 to 45 feet. It's comparable to ours. They can see color and they can see black and white.
Okay, so that really, really neat side note there, I think. Color, black and white. That might sound awful, of course, because that's what we can see, but within the animal kingdom, that's quite rare, isn't it?
It is.
Alright, moving even closer, we're now 4 inches away from the shark, and finally, this very cool sixth sense, as it's called, kicks in. Again, 5 senses for most of the animal kingdom. Sharks are one of the most amazing predators because of this sixth sense. What is it?
They can pick up electricity in the water.
Okay.
Now, a lot of us have heard that before. We think that, oh my gosh, they're going to sense in the water beating from far away, but it only works as close as 4 inches, 4 inches or less. It helps sharks, especially bottom dwellers, find animals that are hiding under the sand. A few inches down, they can dig it up with their snout. And hammerheads are the best family of sharks to be able to do that because they have such a big surface area around their head. They have a lot more pores for sensing electricity. So if you look very closely at the snout of a shark, you can see these tiny little pores. It looks like little freckles on their face.
And I think that's really useful for that. So essentially, it's every time a heart beats, regardless of whether it's a shrimp's heart, or a fish's heart, or a crab's heart, it gives off this a little electrical impulse, right? And that's what they're essentially sensing with this ampullae of Lorenzini. So that's jaw. We'll get to that in just a minute when we talk about teeth. But we want that picture of the ampullae. It's all the little polka dots on the nose of a shark. And so they might not be able to smell their prey. They might not be able to hear it. They might not be able to senses other than with the ampullae of Lorenzini. And so they're traveling close. Again, 4 inches is how far it works. And they might sense that electrical impulse and use their snout to uncover it. Again, what's making them a really amazing predator, because all the other predators would just keep on going. The shrimps under the sand, they don't sense it. But the shark can now. Excuse me. What a big shark, like a great white shark, use this sense.
They can, but they're not going to use it as much as the bottom-dwelling animals that are looking for animals that are hiding under rocks and sand. So yes, they can. They typically will use that as they near in on prey. So they're using their other senses, like sight, like their lateral lines, and their sense of smell to detect a prey. And then as they get closer, that electro sensitivity is going to kick in for those larger sharks.
Right, so this isn't, you know, a great white shark isn't going to swim real close to the sea line to sense it with an ampullae Lorenzini. So this is, excuse me, I am so sorry, everyone. This is something that's for that bottom dwelling shark, right?
Yeah.
Alright. So when we think of sharks, we definitely think of teeth, and we've seen some great images in the last few seconds of some teeth and sharks. Before we get to teeth, though, I do want to show you one of our mystery items today. We do, in fact, have several, so giving a picture of the mystery item, perhaps you've already seen it. It looks like a brown blob, which is here on our table, but if you get a close-up, you see a little bit better there. So as usual, you are welcome to call or go ahead and, if you are on the chat board today, you are welcome to send your guests that way. 1-800-339-1193. What is that thing that you see? And let me give you a little comparison. There is a typical pin. So that gives you a sense of how big it is. So again, when we think of sharks, we definitely think of their teeth. Sharks are made of cartilage, so are their teeth. But what that means is that they're not really fused in to their jaw, right? And so that causes a loss of a lot of teeth.
Yeah, sharks typically have about 3,000 teeth in their mouth at one time, and they'll lose up to 30,000 teeth in their lifetime. Because their teeth just sit there in their gums, it's not fused to any jawbone down here at the bottom like our teeth are. So they have 6 to 8 rows of teeth that are constantly falling out. As soon as they eat something, that pressure on the tooth makes that tooth in the front fall out. It's kind of like a conveyor belt of teeth. The next tooth just pops, kind of rotates forward into place. It takes a little bit of time. It's not an instant rotation there, of course. I guess that they need energy in the body to store that forward for the next time that they're going to eat. So they do lose their teeth a lot.
Yeah.
So it gives us some strength.
Yeah. Some sharks can go up to lose and regrow up to 30,000 teeth in their lifetime. 30,000. We do have some great guesses coming in. We had a shark egg. In fact, it is just after that we had Corey with a horn shark egg case, and that is exactly the right answer. It is a horn shark egg case. So Sarah is going to talk to us a little bit more about this later in our class as we talk about shark reproduction. But until that, we will just tell you that a baby shark once resided in this very bizarre looking thing that you can see here. It really does look exactly like a horn. And again, we'll tell you a little bit more about that later. Rachel, it is an egg case. Very good. A lot of you guys coming through with some great guesses, I should say. Corey was first one at that extra credit point. So 30,000 teeth in our lifetime, and that's certainly not the typical shark, but there is one shark out there that can lose and regrow that many, and some can have up to 25 rows of teeth. And if you've ever seen a shark jaw before, you've seen one, Sabrina's describing, it's almost like these teeth are laying down, like ready and waiting for their turn, and again, they do rotate forward, and they never stop going teeth. It's like a factory of teeth that, when we're done with our adult teeth, one falls out, and we've got to go get ourselves a fake one. But not sharks, it's like a factory in there. So there's a few different kinds of teeth. The one that we're seeing here is, we really just call it shark and pointy. Now that might sound a little bit ridiculous, but it is different than a few other shark teeth we'll look at in a minute. What would this guy be good at eating?
Well, because he's got these long, pointy, narrow, sharp teeth, he's good at puncturing the skin of a slippery, slimy fish. And that fish is not going to slip right out of his mouth. So he can hold on to it, make sure it gets back into his throat. And the fact that they all stick out kind of at different angles too ensures that he's going to hold on to that fish and his mouth and can't get away.
So essentially anything that's slippery and slimy, that long, skinny tooth is very good at holding on to. And there's no ripping, there's no tearing. It literally is bite slippery, slimy animal and swallow it. So mostly fish, but certainly squid are another prey item that can be eaten with this kind of tooth. The difference is what you're going to see here in a minute is serrated. And you'll see that these two teeth look very similar to first glance. They're large, they're triangular, they are what we think of when we think of a shark. But there's a huge difference with not only the tooth and its structure, but also what is eaten with that tooth. So let's go ahead and talk about the serrated teeth as we see them there on the screen.
Now that shows a great image of those rows of teeth laying back there. So the serrated teeth you'll typically find on larger open ocean sharks, like great whites, tiger sharks, bull sharks, because that is essentially this jagged edge along the side of their teeth used for tearing and shearing their food. And so they're going to eat typically larger animals like marine mammals, dolphins, baby whales, seals, and sea lions. These teeth can actually cut through that layer of blubber.
And so all you have to do is think about your meat, your piece of chicken, your piece of steak, your piece of salmon. You're not going to go to the kitchen drawer and get that butter knife. You're going after something that's serrated, that steak knife. And this is the very reason why. You're using that fork and a knife to be able to cut a smaller piece. Their fork and knife is essentially in their mouth. This is a ripping and tearing sort of tooth. And so they grab that big animal, seal, sea lion, whatever it might be, and shake their head back and forth. The closest thing I can liken it to is my dog. When he grabs his stuffed toy, whatever it might be, because he has a million, he's very spoiled, he shakes his head, and I just think that's a predatory instinct, and that's definitely seen in the shark. So this is not something that they eat whole. While it might sound very gruesome, they do eat their prey items in pieces. So you see these jagged edges, or the serrated edges, as we call them. It is going to be a larger shark, A, and then therefore eat large items in not one bite, exactly, in daring kind of situation. Now, sea rays, their cousin, as I call them, not terribly the group term, but close enough, they're the same big group, right? They're related. They have really interesting teeth. In fact, when you see this picture, you might even wonder where the teeth are. And we get that question a lot when we show this jaw. Okay, I see the tongue, but where are the teeth? But you're looking at the teeth.
Yeah, that's not the tongue. Right. Yeah, that looks like it. I heard a lot of guests at the aquarium compare it to snake skin. What it looks like and kind of what it feels like. But the stingrays and skates have flat teeth, and typically guitar fish have some type of flat tooth as well. They use that for grinding and crushing hard-shelled animals, so like bivalves, oysters and clams, and mussels, those kinds of things are snails, and animals with tougher exoskeletons too, shrimp and crabs.
And it's like a nutcracker or a crab cracker, I guess you call it a crab cracker. Because they suck the animal in and they place it on this flat surface you see in the background. Down comes that upper jaw and they crunch it up. And then most of the time the shells then fall out of the mouth and they're really after the yummy insides, the soft body of the clam, crab, mussel, whatever it might be. So even in our stingray exhibit at the aquarium, we give them mussels. And the mussel shells are literally littering rather the sand on the bottom because they don't eat the shell. A lot of pressure, as you can imagine, so I'm not going to say it wouldn't hurt if your finger got stuck in there, but it wouldn't get caught because you can see totally flat. Exactly the same as us, guys. If we take a bite of that hamburger, the food goes to the flat parts, obviously the flat teeth, and then we swallow it. So that's how we teach children about it. The aquarium just have flat crushing for the teeth. And again, this is about ready. You can maybe see some of the writing there. This is actually a replica. It's called bone clones, and that's how we get a lot of our jaws and a lot of our skulls these days. It's a much more controlled environment, meaning we know where they're coming from, whereas that hasn't always been the case when acquiring a sharp jaw from outside sources. So we're pretty excited to have that now. Bone clones is just recently started to make jaws because of Catherine, that voice that you heard earlier. She actually got that bone, so that was very fabulous. Not all sharks have teeth. And again, this is something that surprises quite a few people. In fact, the two big sharks in the world's oceans do not have teeth. You think shark, you think big, you think teeth. Not the case at all. Go ahead and tell us about the second big guy and then the biggest guy.
Well, the second biggest guy is that basking shark, and the top one is the whale shark. Both of these sharks are filter feeders. They do have remnants of teeth. They have very small teeth that line their mouth that they don't even use at all. Instead, they open their mouths very wide, as you can you'll see here, on the image right here. That's an image of a basking shark. And instead, they have gill rakers, kind of little protrusions that stick out from their gills that catch small microscopic plankton and krill out of the water. So their filter feeders, they feed like baleen whales, like whales that don't have teeth.
Right. So there are whales with no teeth in the world, and then there are sharks with no teeth as well. Very similar. So essentially, on a gill filament, if you got to look inside those gills, you see on the side of a shark,
Part of it is going to be big and red, exchanging oxygen, very bloody. Part of it is going to be quite so fuzzy looking, for lack of a better term. And then in these animals, the other part is the gill breakers. And do a Google search if you want to an image search, and you can see the gill breakers are like long fingers. They can be very, very long. So essentially, part of the gill is used for breathing, exchanging the oxygen from the water, and then the other part is that gill breaker, and it really is like a filter, right? All of the little creatures get stuck in those gill breakers, and then with suction, they just pull it down their throat, right? And this is a whale shark that does the exact same thing. You might think that it's still scary, right? It's still a really big animal, but their throat is no bigger than a grapefruit or something. It's silly. Now, Sabrina, you actually had a really close encounter with a whale shark. And when I say encounter, I don't put a negative spin on that. It was exciting.
It was very exciting.
Tell us about that.
It's a gold mine to swim with whale sharks, the largest facial largest shark in the world. On average, they get to around 40 feet max. I think the largest one ever found was around 55 to 60 feet. And they're incredible. Even though they're so huge, they're very majestic. They're slow moving. They have a tail that helps them to get speed, utilize their energy in a very easy fashion, similar to the zebra shark that we saw. So they're slow movers, very majestic. I was 5 feet from one. At one point, we had four of them around us. And you can see them looking at us with the same inquiry that we have about them, just rotating their eyes around, kind of figuring out their environment just as much as we do and other animals do. And they were harmless. They're amazing and beautiful creatures to see.
And there's a few places you can see them around the world. And Sabrina had the privilege of going to Belize, right? And they are there one specific time every year. And the same is true of Mexico and of Australia. Why are they there only? I mean, do they have a calendar? I'm only going to go here in March. Are they on vacation? Why do they go there?
I guess you can say they kind of follow a lunar calendar. And they go to those areas to feed during the spring when there's a lot of plankton growth and when there's a lot of fish that are reproducing. And so they feed on the plankton and they'll feed on the larvae and the eggs released into the water during mass spawnings of specific fish species in those areas around the world.
So last week we talked about bony fish reproduction and one of the main kinds being spawning. And again, they all kind of congregate here in Southern California, sand bass, for example, over those sand flats and spawn. And these guys know it basically, and they come from far and wide. They're following that same lunar calendar as the bony fish that are spawning because it's a full moon. And they come not to spawn with the bony fish, rather than to hunt to eat to get a meal. And it's just fascinating. And next year, I am going to go. I was supposed to go this year. I must. I'm very, very excited. One thing that has been tossed around is that they're scared of the scuba diving bubbles and you have to snorkel with them. Is that true?
We did not find that to be true. The scuba diving company that I went down, underwater with down in Belize, they actually had all of us, there were 12 of us in our group, we had a big circle underwater about 80 feet below the surface and created a lot of bubbles. They said, keep breathing, release a lot of bubbles, and the whale shark would swim right above your head through those bubbles, thinking that all those little bubbles were eggs that they could eat. So it was incredible. It got them over. They were interested and curious in us. They weren't afraid of us at all.
That's really neat. So those are whale sharks, guys. The biggest shark in the ocean, but it also has two categories because, again, sharks are a kind of fish, and not only the biggest shark, but of course the biggest fish as well. Unfortunately, the basking sharks, the second biggest we just mentioned, not doing real well. The same might be true here of the whale sharks. And basking sharks specifically, they are thinking that it is due to that shark finning. It's a very sad thing. We will talk about it later, as we mentioned a few times throughout the class in our conservation section near the end. Now, I do want to go back to something that we skipped, but it's very, very important, and that is the scales of the shark. There are four basic kinds of scales that any given fish might have in the world, but within the world of sharks, is one kind of scale, and it's called a planchoid scale.
but more specifically, it's called dermal denticles. So it breaks down to mean something that makes a lot of sense. So
yeah. Literally, it means skin and teeth. So dermal, like the epidermis or the epidermal layer, is skin, and then denticle is the word for tooth. You can find the root in dentist and dental. So that's what they literally are. They are miniature versions of their teeth. Microscopic, you see all over their skin. You can see on the picture behind us a good image under a microscope of shark skin. That looks like it's most likely from a horn shark up in that image.
Okay. Now, that doesn't mean that they're sharp. That's something, well, if they're made of the same material as the teeth, then it's really a shark. And there's also the mystery that if you pet a shark one way from head to tail, then it's okay. But if you go backwards, you're going to get cut. Is that true?
You're not going to get cut, but you can feel kind of that point at the edge of the back of those scales. And it does actually put pressure on the shark's skin because you're going against the grain when you're touching them. So it is safer if you are interacting with sharks at the aquarium or anywhere else to touch them gently on the back from head to tail.
Focus. And we do have a close-up version, I think, of a dermal denticle. And this will, if you have that picture, give you a good sense of what Sabrina means at the point. But it is kind of this big scale, and it has a little triangle point at the end. But I want you to tell us a little bit before we go to break here in a few minutes about your research with dermal denticles specifically when you were at the University of Irvine, right?
Yes. So there I worked in a biomechanics lab. It was a marine biomechanics lab. So we did, we looked at shark skin, and we actually did dissections, and we stretched the skin. We were looking at how strong it was, what kind of strain that it could handle. And for that, we wanted to take a look at the structure, compare it from different species, so four different species. And we looked at how scientists and engineers can replicate the structures of the skin and use that for swimsuits, which I know lots of scientists have been doing. So I helped a little bit with that for my professor in getting papers out. So that was exciting for me. And that helped researchers to kind of get to conclusion on you can replicate that. It can be used on swimsuits, can be used at the bottom of boat holes, can be used on airplanes, and it reduces drag. It helps to streamline their body, those shapes of the scales. Help with protection, help with streamlining, help with speed. And so it would reduce the cost of fuel for airplanes if they used not shark skin itself, but a film layer that had the same structure and look to shark skin.
So transferring hydrodynamic of being very quick and slick in the water, yes, to their turn to aerodynamics. Yes. It's really neat next time you watch the Olympics or any major swim race. A lot of the Olympians or swimmers either no longer have the normal swimsuit on, but they have these big, long suits that go all the way down to their feet. And it's because of the research that Sabrina was mentioning that that makes them more hydrodynamic than just having their bare skin. And so it might shave off a fraction of a second, which would help them win that that gold medal, maybe. And it's fascinating that sharks have, you know, kind of transferred their use of things like airplanes and fast swimmers and that kind of thing. So those are dermal denticles, literally meaning skin and teeth, and all sharks have them. But what about stingrays? Do stingrays have them too?
They typically do have a similar scale on their skin. You can't see it as well. They're much smaller, so they're even more microscopic. And then you can feel them because they also, in their skin, secrete mucus that protects them. So if you were to touch the stingray, you're going to feel this smooth, soft layer of skin. And that's the mucus that you're feeling. You won't feel their scales at all.
Now, I know you might be thinking of the parrotfish, but they do not make a mucus sleeping bag. But they do. Very cool. The stingray has a mucus sleeping bag, too. But I don't know, maybe people at school, they just have mucus on their body at all times. And they are a little bit slimy. But don't worry, when you touch a stingray, you don't get a mucus on your hands or anything.
It does not come off.
It doesn't go off.
No.
It stays on the hands. They are mucus, but it is on those dermal denticles. So they don't feel like sandpaper like a shark would. Yeah. They're much more slippery.
Alright, you guys, oh, I was going to mention too, a dermal denticle that you're probably most familiar with is the stinger on the stingray. That's a modified dermal denticle as well.
You've seen a shark one, and yes, you've seen a bar and have a gas
guys can see in the image behind me, on a stingray, as just a side note here, very important to point out, that is the stingray bar. So you can see it's all halfway back on their body and right there, so that's not their whole tail. Just real quickly before we go to break, Sabrina, tell us why they use their barb. And I'm sure many people, and we have definitely heard a lot about Steve Irwin and why he died because of the stingray. So tell us a little bit about that as a insight.
Well, typically, it's only used for defense. It's an adaptation specifically for defending itself. It has serrated edges. There is venom that does travel up the outside of the stinger into the predator, the animal, or person that is stinging. And that's what creates that stinging sensation. It is a toxin that can only be broken down with heat. That's what kills the enzymes on that. And there's various levels of toxicity from species to species. Some of them is more toxic than others. And unfortunately, people do get stung typically just by threatening the animals. Sometimes they don't even realize it. I've stepped on one getting off my boogie board. And that threatened the poor guy. I stepped on it. I didn't know it was there. And so he defended himself and got me right in the foot. And so it does happen. That's their way of surviving.
And so just imagine you're this little circular creature. You're sitting on the bottom of the ocean. All of a sudden, big foot comes to step on you. You're going to defend yourself. And that's essentially what happens. They're not out there getting you. Imagine they have to like swim backwards and try to aim their stinger right in your leg. It just doesn't happen. They bring it around, it comes into your ankle, and it's over. They don't mean to do it. They're defending themselves. In the case of Steve Irwin, I think, as far as I know, was right over that stingray, and it was just the worst combination of errors you could possibly imagine. That animal did bring that tail up with the stinger, and it was very bizarre that it went into something other than his foot. That's usually what happens, and unfortunately, it did hit him there in the heart. Levi Allison has a question. What are dermal denticles used for? So specifically, it's kind of like a suit of armor for them. So they do feel a lot like sandpaper when you touch them, and so it helps them be very rough and very strong, and it also helps them be very fast, so that streamlines, as Serena was mentioning earlier, that really helps them glide through water, and here a scientist can tell a little bit better than some of the other kinds of scales. Flacoid scale, basically, Ali, is another way. It's a scientific term. So there's tenoid scales, there's flacoid scales. It's the kind of scale, the shape of scale, that is specific to sharks. So they all have flacoid scales. All right, guys, so we're going to go ahead and take a break, get a snack, get some drink, and we'll see you back in about 6 minutes.
Hey, what's up? I'm Nicole Harris.
That's one of the main things that put me here. Kelsey, thank you. Possibly if our students have a specific GPA requirement that corresponds with their SAT or ACT score. Higher your GPA, the less weight they put on the score. The lower your GPA, the stronger that they need to be.
Students with GPAs below 2.0 are not eligible for admission.
For California residents, the average meal tax at public university is $3,400, not including the cost of books or housing. Most students pay about $400 extra per unit. The university offers many financial aid options, including scholarships and grants.
Dual states make us choosing your choice of 45 bachelor's, 21 master's degrees, and 10 teaching credit certificate programs. Some of the students' favorite majors include liberal studies, business administration, digital media arts, child development, and nursing.
Want to work in television or the motion picture and music industries? Cal State Davisville's Digital Media Arts program successfully prepares students for careers in those fields.
The legend holds true. There's a ghost in every theater. The Davisville spirit comes to every play, opens the elevator doors, and wishes the cast good luck.
Trinity University also holds its master's degree program in quality resolution and peacebuilding. Plus, the orthotics and prosthetics program is one of only 7 such programs in the nation.
With 687 faculty members, the university has a student-to-faculty ratio of 23:1.
The university has 11 men's and women's girls athletic teams, including at the NCAA Division II level.
Our tour is going to be great for the final 3 national championships.
Okay, Cal State students, unlike most college residents, are also dormitories. The complex consists of 22 two-story buildings with 1, 2, and 3 bedroom furnished apartments, all with full kitchens. The apartments were originally built to house athletes for the 1984 Summer Olympics.
I do currently live in Campus Valley, and it's a nice experience. I don't have mom here to tell me what to do. Also, it gives me the opportunity to interact with people on the more intimate setting.
To meet students can select from 60 standalone groups to join or participate in, from cultural and special interest organizations to professional service and honor society groups. There are also 5 fraternities and 8 sororities on campus, some of whose origins have Latino or African American beginnings.
There's a lot of students who get involved. They love to be involved in clubs, organizations, sports, or friends. But we can all get sad as we look at a dodgeball tournament.
Addicted to reality TV? Well, here's your reason to get off the couch. The Associate Students Corporate and Put Activities Together pushes every year. Today, the Amazing Race.
Danny Grissett, the pianist composer who has worked with people like Herbie Hancock and Prince, DC Nash, and actors whose television credits include Reno 911 and Clean House, and John Langley, the co-creator and executive producer of the classically entertaining Cops.
The very first ever I think cast of Biggest Hills would be home. Yes, it is at home.
If you're looking for a friendly student from the university where you won't feel lost and it seems like everyone knows your name, be sure to check out Cal State Dominguez Hills in the heart of beautiful Southern California.
Thanks for joining us here in Carson, California on our campus tour at 1240 State University of Dominguez Hills. Bye! Alright, welcome back to our class on sharks. We're going to just continue right on our pathway about down Shark Avenue, I guess we'll call it, learning all about sharks. And we are going to dive into the world of reproduction in sharks because, to be perfectly honest, it is a very fascinating. When we talk about bony fish, there were a few different kinds of reproduction within the world of sharks. I suppose the same could be true, but there are even more fun facts to be shared for sure about shark reproduction. First of all, we will begin with the external anatomy of a shark. We were able to take a look at that bull shark earlier, looking at the fins, looking at that fusiform shape. But how do you tell the difference between a girl shark and a boy shark? And that is something that can be done externally. That isn't something that's always readily apparent on a bony fish. So that's another difference. And you'll see it there in the background. So what is it, Sabrina?
Well, if you see the image here on your left, that is the image of a male. You can see those two extensions of the skin right behind those fins. Those are called claspers. And claspers are used for internal fertilization. All sharks reproduce by internal fertilization. So one of those claspers would be inserted into the female's cloaca. And if you look at the image on the right, then you can see the cloaca on the female. So notice she does not have the claspers, only the males have that reproductive structure.
What we see here in this image here with the two claspers is that lead to two baby sharks because there are two openings in and two uteruses and two babies.
Yep, so there's one uterus and the two ovaries that are there, just like in mammals. There's one opening, one cloaca, and so one clasper is going to be inserted to the cloaca, and the other clasper is actually for helping to position the female and hold onto her.
Okay. And we do have a picture of that, the white tip sharks mating. Unfortunately, they were not alone. You can see a bunch of scuba divers in the background, but of course, I guess this is how we're learning about them. And someone took a picture so we can see. So internal fertilization. And so the same as mammals, obviously, and one might believe that it would result then in one baby white tip shark. But that is definitely not true. In fact, some sharks that have this internal fertilization can have lots of babies, can't they?
Yes, spiny dogfish can actually have plenty of babies. They can have litters. And they have a longer gestation period, too, up to 24 months. But there are other sharks that can have litters. Hammerhead, all the sharks in the hammerhead family, bonnet heads, bull sharks, great white sharks. There's just a lot of them that can give you lots of the spectrum of your mind.
And even the tiger shark familiar can have.
The tiger shark can have babies.
That's amazing. Okay, so that is internal reproduction or internal fertilization resulting in a live birth. But not always is it the case that the baby inside is connected to the mom. So it might appear that it's like mammalian birth, again, that the baby is feeding off of the nutrients and such from the mom and then born. But that's not always the case, right? So if that's the case, it's called vivid birth, live birth. So the baby is connected to the mom gives birth, very much like mammalian, but a different, it can be ovovivid birth, right?
So 57% of sharks do give live birth, but there are actually two forms of live birth. So there's viviparity, like Sarah said, and that's where they have a placental attachment. But there is ovoviviparity, and that's where there's an internalized egg case. So imagine an egg case like the horn shark egg that you saw, except that egg case never comes out into the water. It never sees the world. That egg case would be dissolved inside of the mother's body, and then that baby would come out alive. So there's no placental attachment in that case. It's an internalized egg that dissolves inside of the mother.
And so to better, to better understand what that might look like, let's go to the actual egg-laying form of sharks. And that's what you see here in the background. So this big brown case is very much like what you saw with that horn shark here. And so explain egg-laying for us, and then we'll revert back to that other form we were just talking about.
Sorry, theory is that a shark or an animal lays eggs. That's the terminology for it. And in this case, there is egg casing. So this brown leather pouch that you see is the egg case, like the egg shell. Right? If you compare it to a chicken egg, that's kind of like the white shell on the outside. Now, we can see through into this egg because it's candled right now. Candling is a process where you shine a light behind that leather egg case or pouch, and you can see the contents inside. So you can see that dark circle, that's actually the yolk sac, kind of like the yellow yolk sac that you would find inside of a chicken egg. And then you can see the little attachment to the yolk sac, and there's that embryo then, that baby shark that is attached to it.
Alright, so as this shark gets bigger, that circle or that yolk is obviously going to get smaller. And so eventually the baby shark will fill up the entire egg case as you see it here, and it kind of does a horseshoe, or it looks like a horseshoe rather, because it is so big, and that's when they hatch in essence. So this case is quite leathery. It's actually in fact very thicker than one might think. So how does the baby shark get out of that then when he's ready? When all of his yolk is gone, he's hungry, he has nothing else to use nutrients.
Well, most sharks will actually, when they get big enough, their nose is kind of pointing into the edge of the egg pouch, and they can kind of push their way out. There are always small openings on each side of the egg pouch, so water constantly flows through there. Those babies do need that water flow over their gills in order to keep breathing. So they can push their way out, and other species will use, they'll release different kinds of chemicals from their body to help dissolve the edges of the case as well.
So it's some sort of enzyme is what I've heard, right?
Yeah.
So they can excrete this enzyme that dissolves that seed, and it's just fascinating to think that there's one enzyme that can actually dissolve the whatever is holding that seed together, and out comes baby shark. So there's no maternal instincts, right? The mom lays a shark and says, good luck, little baby.
They do not care for their young at all.
And you'll notice there in the background, guys, and we did talk about this on the first day a little bit, the kelp forest. Remember, the kelp forest, very much this brown color. And this is the coloration, something that would help them if the mom does lay it in that algae, that it helps it camouflage. And so that's pretty much as far as they go in terms of helping their baby. They try and lay it in a camouflage environment so other animals don't come along and eat it. Now, with this horn shark, let's go ahead and get an image of that one more time as we talk about it. We do have a different mystery item to show you here. So with this horn shark here, again, the baby is living inside. And this end that you guys see there, that seam, is where the baby would come out. But what the mom does with this is quite fascinating. She almost drills this into a crack or a crevice, right? So she would, as she lays it, she tries to do so near a rock, crack, or crevice, and again, it gets it stuck in there, so maybe other predators cannot get it out. This is our next mystery item for the class, so if you happen to know what that is, go ahead and email us. Matt Vivipary, V-I-V-I-P-A-R-Y, I think, or is it Parody? P-A-R-I-D-Y.
I-T-Y.
I-T-Y. Okay.
Vivid Parody.
Vivid Parody. P-A-R-I-T-Y. There we go. Okay. I have to write it down to spell it correctly. Hopefully you got that now. All right. Call us for, go ahead and chat board if you know what that mystery item is. So egg laying, you guys, it's very fascinating. We have three local species of sharks that we'll show you here a little bit later. Two of them do lay the egg cases. One is that horn shark who we just saw the egg case. Another is a swallow shark that looks very much like the one that you saw on the screen. Back in the aquarium, we do have those guys. In addition, in our shark lagoon, we have some bamboo sharks, and they also lay egg cases. But there is a difference in the amount of time that the baby stays in the egg case. The process by which everything happens, of them using the yolk as nutrients, the yolk gets smaller, the baby gets bigger, makes sense. But that doesn't take the same amount of time in each of those, so in each egg-laying species, right?
Yeah, it varies from species to species. So, for example, bamboo sharks that you mentioned, they typically grow inside the egg case from 3 to 5 months, and then they hatch.
whereas the zebra shark, the one you saw earlier swimming in the aquarium, that one will take anywhere from 7 to 10 months to develop. So it does vary from species to species.
Now, we don't have a picture, unfortunately, but if you ever come to the aquarium, you'll see where we actually window the shark egg cases. And Sabrina talks about the flashlight and candling it, so showing from behind. But we want to show our visitors what it looks like inside. And so, in fact, they have something called shark egg casing or windowing. And so they use very sharp scissors to cut out a box or a window in that very leathery case. And then they use a transparency, very much like you've seen in school. They use a square of that transparency, glue it down with non-water soluble glue. And then we have a little picture there. We can see right into the window and see the shark eggs or the shark developing. It's a really, really neat thing. And maybe next time we do Live from AOP, I can show you one of those. So that gives you kind of an idea of how it is a shark tooth, but you need to be a little bit more specific for me. So we do have a guest coming in of a shark tooth. We'll see it again here compared to a pin. That might help you a little bit. That is how big it is compared to a pin. So it is a shark tooth. It is a megalodon tooth. Very good job, Levi. It is a megalodon. So Levi Allison is going to get that. So really quickly, Sabrina, tell us what a megalodon shark, where can I find one of those?
Well, they do not exist here, but we can find them longer.
Wow.
They actually lived in the Miocene, Pleistocene, and just from looking at the tooth that we have in front of us is how we figure out how old they were with carbon dating. So that's how we can estimate the time period that they lived. And also, we can estimate its size by looking at the size of that tooth. By looking at current existing shark species, we compare the size of their body, the length of their body to the size of their tooth. We can get a proportion of body length to tooth. And you can take that information and figure out the length of the megalodon by looking at its tooth and measuring it. So they would have been about 2 to 3 times the size of an average great white today. They are ancestors to the great white shark. Their teeth look very similar to this tooth up here. They have the serrated edges. They have that similar root there and structure and shape and use. And so we know that they were ancestors to the great white.
So they predict maybe a shark that was 100 feet long. Now keep in mind the longest whale shark, maybe 60 feet. Comparison, you guys, the average school meal, school bus you see is about 45, 50 feet long, I think. So that gives you a sense of how big this animal must have been with these enormous teeth that could get to be even bigger than the one that we have right here, up to 6 inches, even longer than an average pin. So one, very good. It is a megalodon tooth, but unfortunately, Levi beat you out just a little bit. So going back to the shark reproduction, we saw that egg case. Imagine that baby shark inside the mom. So he's using that egg case, not connected to the mom, very much like the egg inside the egg case, but rather that's happening inside the mom, and then the baby is born appearing to be live birth. But sometimes there is a baby shark that uses its own yolk sac a little bit too fast. It's not ready to come out yet, it hasn't developed, it doesn't have eyes, whatever, it might be missing some gills. So, and you think, well, maybe you even perish, right? It doesn't have the yolk sac. Not the case. They turn to another food source. What do these guys do?
There's something called ovophagy. And so sometimes in the body of the mother in her womb, she has plenty of young inside of her, and one of them, the thickest of the group, will turn and eat the yolk sacs of its brothers and sisters, and even its brothers and sisters. And then that one individual is born then. So it's also called intrauterine cannibalism.
So cannibalism, of course, being the word for when an animal eats its own kind. So when this happens in the uterus before they even come and join us here on Earth. And it is known to, I think, what is it, 9 or 10 species or even more?
Currently 9, and they're finding that it's done more.
Now, how does one find out that this happens? Is there a little camera there on the uterus, or how do you find out? Do you know?
Typically, they found out by doing dissections, and they found just sex left behind, or just the other embryos, the dead brothers and sisters, and not the eggs left behind. So there's two different forms they can eat, the yolk sac and the other embryo that's attached to it. They can eat just the embryo and leave the yolk sac, or they can eat the yolk sac and leave the embryo. Whatever is most nutritious for that species of sharks to survive.
So maybe a fisherman catches a female shark and they begin to cut it open and find the situation, and ultimately they thought, well, this must be what happens in intrauterine cannibalism. Not something that I think is prevalent in any other animal that I know about. So again, something that makes some sharks just fascinating. We do have a sand tiger shark at the aquarium, and that is one of the species that is known to have intrauterine cannibalism. We do have one last mystery item for the day. There it is, and it's a little bit harder to see just because it is it's a little bit brighter, but as usual, I will compare it to a pin. So if you think you know what that is, go ahead and get in touch with us. You can call us 1-800-339-1193. Ali is asking us, when do they go extinct? I don't know, sharks, I think is what we're referring to here, must be. And it was 100 million years ago, do you recall? Yes, about 100 million years ago, Ali. So it's been quite some time since those guys were here on Earth with us. All right, guys, so we've talked a lot about sharks here today and why they are so neat, fun facts, as I call them. And now we're going to get into the conservation side of sharks, as it is very prevalent and it's very, very important in our world's oceans right now. We do have a guest. It is a state jaw. It is not a sea jaw. A stingray mouth thing. A little bit closer, Allie. You guys are both right in the sense that it is a mouth. Neither of those guesses are correct. Sharks are, let's begin, Serena, I'd like to begin with, on a positive note, in terms of why sharks are important. Why does the world need sharks? Unfortunately, because of movies like Jaws, and I think we even have a Jaws poster, we have a very negative feeling towards sharks. And when I say we, I mean the general public, and we see this in the aquarium quite a bit. So why are they so important? Why not just get rid of all of them if they're so vicious?
Well, they are actually extremely important for the environment. If they are an apex predator or at the top of their food chain, not all sharks are, but several of them are. Most of them are. And when they're at the top of the food chain, they determine the balance below them, between the life that's living. They determine the diversity. Because if you're looking at a food chain, right, you have the great white, and it's going to feed on sea otter, say, in the kelp forest. That feeds on urchins, and the urchins feed on the kelp. Well, if we get rid of the great white shark, the sea otter population can explode because there isn't a shark there to keep its numbers down and in check, in balance. And so when those numbers explode as sea otters, then the sea urchin populations will decline rapidly because there's so many sea otters eating away their numbers. So there's this domino effect when you eliminate an animal from a food chain and essentially a food web, with everything being so connected in lots of different ways. So in that case, those sharks, they determine the function of an ecosystem. They determine the diversity and the abundance.
Okay, so it's a checks and balances system. We have a lot of questions coming through. You guys are really good guesses, but Selena, you are absolutely correct for that Port Jackson shark jaw, and I would like for you to write in how you knew that. That is excellent. This is not the average jaw that you see. We did talk a lot about teeth earlier. Tell us a little bit before I move on to some conservation screen about these teeth. Very strange.
You can see if you look closely at the teeth that there are flat teeth. They're kind of bulbous. They look a little rounded to them. And those are good for crushing hard-shelled animals like the rays. Then up towards the front, they have these small spiky teeth. And those are good for initially grabbing and pulling something into their mouth. So they're opportunistic feeders. They can eat some small, slippery fish, and maybe even some small squid or octopus. But they can also eat hard-shelled animals. So they have a very generalistic, very diverse diet.
Sounds pretty good. I mean, they're opportunistic, right? If they need to crush something, they have those. But if they need to pierce something, they have those. Teeth as well. Not something that's terribly common in a shark jaw having both of those, and I think that's what makes that Port Jackson a really
really neat shark. All right, so Lena getting that extra credit point. Excellent job. So you can kind of think of this situation as a balloon. When the sharks go down, there's not enough of them to eat the predator. So the predator gets really, really big. There's too many of them, and whatever they eat gets really, really small. And so it kind of looks like this hourglass that goes in and out, and it's really quite dangerous because one of the species is going to suffer. Eventually, their numbers will get so low that they will go extinct, and I think we're just starting to see some of those effects in the ocean right now. And that tells you why sharks are so important. We must have them, but you must be thinking, and a lot of people are, well, they're so dangerous. That movies like Open Ocean was the most recent one, and Jaws certainly did sharks absolutely no favors. I believe it was back in the 80s, in terms of them being very, very dangerous. But if you're scared of a shark, you should also be scared of a coconut, a toilet, a vending machine, not even a vending machine, but rather a California freeway, a trampoline, a mini blind. Whelping.
Where are all these things coming from? Well, statistically, you're more likely to have fatalities for people due to coconuts falling on their head or being bitten by pigs. So basically, what we're saying is on average, every single year around the entire world, more people die from a coconut falling on their head than by shark attacks. More people die every year from hitting their head on the toilet, from being bitten by a cat. Each of these individually, I don't mean all combined. So you're more likely to die by one of those.
And so, well, what happens is a case of mistaken identity, guys, and that is the picture that you see here in the background of essentially some of the shark attacks are a mistake. What are we looking at here?
Here you can see there's an image of kind of a shadow of a sea lion, which Sarah is circling currently. And then next to that is an image of a surfer on a surfboard. Now, if waters are murky, or if a shark is not paying too much attention to its vision and is paying attention to the splashing from its lateral line that it's feeling the water movement in the water, and paying attention to other senses like smell, it might get these two images confused. It might think that that surfer on the board looks like a sea lion from above it, so you're sitting on the surface. And so that's the case of mistaken identity, which is one theory as to why sharks do attack people. There are other theories as to the fact that we are mammals, and sea lions are mammals too, and they give off the same type of amino acids in their sweat that we do, so sharks can pick up on those in the water too.
And simply opportunistic, again, of what is that? I'm hungry, I will go see what it is. And I think that's more of the case of a bull shark and a tiger shark. But keep in mind that these are very loose statistics, but in 2008, there were roughly, less than 100, we'll go with that. I think it was about 80 reported shark attacks worldwide. However, in 2008, human beings killed between 1.5 and 2 million sharks. 1.5 and 2 million sharks were killed in 2008. You compare 1.5 million to 80, and you have to ask yourself who the true predator is. And that might sound a bit harsh in the sense that, of course, that's not to undermine the shark attacks that do happen, but the fact is that we're not their food. They are not out there to eat us. They are not out there to get us, and they are very important animals that do deserve to be in the ocean, and not only deserve, they need to be there. So why are we killing so many of them, millions literally every year?
Well, shark fin is a commodity, and so shark skin, as well as their teeth. But it's mainly shark finning that does the majority of the damage to their populations with the way that it's done. There are markets in the countries that sell shark fin for shark fin soup, sort of a food source for humans. And it's a status of wealth as well in a lot of countries, and it has a cultural value in some countries. We just need to make sure we do it more sustainably in a safer way, is what I mean. Because the way that they are taken from the ocean is they're brought up as many as they can get, as quick as they can. Fishermen are bringing them up onto boats, slicing off their fins, all of their fins, and tossing the carcass back in the water. And we know they can't survive without these fins. So unfortunately, there's a lot of damage to their populations. They have reports of boats coming back with, they've killed 1,000 sharks in an hour. that's how quickly that they're bringing them up, as fast as those fins are getting rid of them.
And earlier we mentioned that basking shark, obviously a very large shark, second largest in the ocean, and with that large body size, clearly comes the large fins. A larger fin would probably get more money in a market when looking at a shark fin value, and that's why they are very much sought after for sure. So obviously a more sustainable practice would be utilizing the whole shark, and that is legislation that is becoming true here in the United States, where the fishing boats have to come back with the entire animal instead of just the fin. As you can imagine, you don't have to bring the big shark body back, and you just have to bring the fins, and you have a lot more room in your boat to bring back just the fins. And so that's legislation. That's one way that you can become active in this, is find out the legislation, find out how you can support that kind of legislation here in the United States. Allies, sharks never eat people. Sharks, very rarely have there been occurrences where the shark consumes the entire person, because typically what happens, and this is anthropomorphizing, which is kind of putting hand thoughts in the shark, but typically the shark bites the person or the surfer and probably thinks to itself, that's not what I wanted. I wanted the big blubbery sea lion. Essentially realizes that's not the food source it was going after and swims away. But an animal that has 3,000 teeth, serrated edge, like we saw earlier on that great white shark or that megalodon, not very much the same, that can really hurt a person, and a lot of times it kills them. And so eating the person, not terribly common, no, because we are, again, not their food. Biting them is definitely what we say, and the bite wound is a lot of times what is eventually fatal for some people, but certainly not all. So, Allie, if that doesn't answer your question, feel free to write back, definitely. So, shark fin, something that typically goes into something called shark fin soup. And again, what we encourage people to do is, as a consumer, meaning when you buy something that is sustainable and will help our ocean's future and the animals in the ocean. So essentially any population, this could be a salmon, this could be a shark, this could be anything. Buy sustainably, meaning buy from a place that we know is helping make sure that population continues. And later in the class, I'll tell you on some tricks of the trade how you can do that. But that's what we ask you to do. And the same is true of shark products, guys. Be very wary of what you buy that contains sharks. It's very unfortunate, and I think that you can speak to this a little bit better. We have a dolphin versus shark picture up here, Sabrina. When we see that dolphin, we think, oh, God, really nice dolphin. When we see that shark, especially that image, and we don't think so cuddly and cute. But what can we do to kind of change the ideas when we see that picture?
I think we need to think about what we've done with conservation for lions in Africa. They were once considered beasts, and they harmed a lot of people, and you know, we need to get rid of them. We don't need them. They're not important. They're just scary animals. But we have changed that attitude, and there's a lot of conservation efforts towards lions, and their populations are increasing and doing much better than in the past. And poaching is down because it's illegal, and it's more enforced over there now than it was before. And we are learning to be more respectful and understanding of lions. And we need to do the same for sharks, because they have, just like lions, determined the function and the diversity of ecosystems in Africa. Sharks do the same in the oceans.
All right, so we do have a question coming in from Juan. Are certain species of sharks specifically targeted for shark finning? Juan, I am quite certain that there are. However, I can't name them off the top of my head. Sabrina, do you know?
Typically, it is the slower-moving sharks. So the basking shark is one of the reasons why, and whale sharks get targeted too, because of that. They're slower-moving. It's an easier catch. So far as I know, besides those two, all sharks are taken, and they'll take any species. And unfortunately, they don't decide if they want to keep the fin for use or not until it's cut off and they're back on the docks. They'll look at it and say, right, they'll just toss it. So it's a very wasteful practice, and limiting how much they can take, like we started to do in U.S. waters in the January of this year, and creating policies, and, you know, we have the right to vote to make a difference for who we're supporting, the policies we support. That makes a difference as to how many they can take, but currently they'll take any species.
All right, we are just going to show a few more pictures of a few sharks we do have that live here in Southern California. We'll start with the leopard shark, a very common species. It's more of an open ocean one. It swims around a little bit more than the other two. And we do have these guys at the aquarium. Serena and I would argue as to whether that animal is gray or brown. I say gray, she says blue. You can vote as you'd like as well. The next one we're going to look at here is a horned shark. And the horned shark is really, really neat because of the two horns you see on the front side of each of those dorsal fins. If you take a look, guys, you'll see little white triangles. Those are horns. The closest thing I can liken it to is if you've ever been eating a bag of chips or Doritos and you bite into that triangular shaped tube chip and it goes to the roof of your mouth, it hurts. And you automatically want to let go of that chip or you want to change that situation. That's pretty much what happens with a predator like a seal or sea lion of this horned shark. You might bite the horned shark, want to eat it. Yes, we do have predators like seals and sea lions. That horn goes into the roof of that sea lion's mouth and then the sea lion might let go. So that's definitely a defense mechanism. And last but not least, this swell shark. Again, you can see they're all bottom-dwelling, fairly small sharks. The leopard shark can get to be about 6 feet. Oh, we don't have a swell shark picture. I'm so sorry about that. We do have a backray and a round stingray shark that we can show you. Matthew is coming to us with a concern. Tell the crew of the U.S. Indianapolis, the sharks don't eat people. Well, I did not say that sharks never, that they sometimes do maximize on their opportunities, and that does happen. That's not something that we disagree with. That does happen. But as a whole, think about 400 plus species of sharks in the world. We're their food. We're not their food. They're not out there to find us. If they all relied on biting and eating us, they would starve to death because we simply are not ocean-dwelling animals and we can't sustain them. What I do want to show you here really quickly, if we can, is get an image of the screen here of Blackboard, if we can. I hope that we can do that through the control room. If not, here we go, guys. So basically, this is what you should be able to see when you log on to Blackboard. And everything you need to be doing is on the left-hand side here, guys. So at the very bottom right here, it says exams and quizzes. This little pop-up right here, it says oceanography quiz. You would simply click on that. Take the quiz from there, as you should see the announcements. If you want to go back, you can click on this up here. You can see the announcements right here, or go to the announcements. It tells you exactly what to do. If you are not on this Blackboard, and if you have never seen this before, you will not be able to complete this class successfully. This is where everything is going to happen. This is the main hub, so I need to make sure all of you are on that. If you have not been able to get in, look in your email. You should have a username and password. And if not, get in touch with me, and I will help you. Again, if you're just watching these classes and you're not on Blackboard, we will not be able to get through this semester together. I have to be able to communicate with you on the Blackboard. If you have questions about getting on, email Warren. You'll see his email pop up here on the bottom, Dr. Ashley. You'll see the email right there. Go ahead and jot it down. Sabrina, I do want to thank you so much for coming to talk to us about sharks today. Hopefully you guys have learned a lot about sharks and how important they are. If you come to the aquarium, you're going to touch a shark and you're not going to be scared because you now know that they are not out there to get us, guys. And in fact, we need them. They're really, really important. Hope you guys have a good rest of the week. Get on that Blackboard. Get some of those assignments done. We'll see you next time, guys.
Thank you.
Animals. Take care.